Hello, welcome to my talk on Newton's invention of calculus, a fantastic application of Newton's calculus for expanding the sine function into infinite series. This is the Newton's derivation before the invention of Taylor series, since Taylor series was not invented yet when Newton derived this. In fact, this development could provide a base for Taylor to develop his series. From this, he can see the complicated functions can be expanded into power series. Also, as a good example for validating the correctness of his series. Hence, in mathematics, the expansion of the sine function into infinite series has been very important. In this talk, we will see how important this development would be. And I will follow Newton's derivation to see what a fantastic application of Newton's calculus. This would include the establishment of the relations of the differentials in graphic drawing. Employ the Newton's binomial series for the complicated binomial function. Use Newton's quadrature rules to obtain the integral of the complicated function. To apply the Newton's inverting algorithm to obtain the series for sine function. And finally, for a comparison, such an infinite series is derived from Taylor series. We will see using Taylor series to expand the sine function would be much simpler. But this talk is how Newton has solved the complicated problem. This fantastic application shows how Newton used his calculus to obtain the infinite series for sine function, which can be regarded as one of the very important development in mathematics. And from this, Newton obtained the infinite series for cosine function. The importance of this specific development includes the illustration of the scale Newton used to solve the complicated problem. Since in Newton's time, Taylor series was not invented yet, and the establishment of an infinite series for the sine function. Again, this clearly shows the trigonometric functions can be expressed as infinite power series, providing a solid idea for Taylor to develop his theory, the Taylor series. Since the complicated functions can be expanded into power series, and this development also provided a good example for validating the Taylor series, forming the base for Euler to establish his formula, e power of I theta equaling to cosine theta plus I sine theta. This formula has greatly simplified the analysis in modern dynamics, since we can simply use e power of I theta instead of the function cosine theta or sine theta. In deriving the infinite series for sine function, Newton applied the following series from his invention of calculus. The binomial series to expand the complicated function into the infinite series. The quadrature rules for integration and the inverting algorithm for the infinite series. Here, we considered a quadrant of a circle centered at the origin with the radius r equaling to unit following the reference. And we let AB equaling to x and bd equaling to y. In the derivation, Newton's initial objective was to find the expression for the length of the arc alpha d given as z as a function of x. Here, the length of the arc alpha d is equaling to r times z. Since r is 1, so the length of the arc is equaling to z. In Newton's derivation, he draw a tangent line dt to the circle at the point d, and he also let bk to be a small increment, bk equaling to dx. Next, he constructed an indefinitely small right angle dgh, and the hypotenuse dh would be very close to dz due to the increment of dx when dx is very small. Now consider the similarity of the triangles. The triangle dgh is similar to the triangle dbt. So we have a relation, the ratio of gh over dh, the hypotenuse, equaling to bt over the hypotenuse of the large triangle dt. And we also have the similar triangles. Triangle ADT is similar to the triangle ABD. So we have the relation BT over DT is equaling to BD over AD. So put this together, we have the relation of GH over DH equaling to BD over AD. So if we apply the notation for the differentiation, GH is DX and DH is DZ, BD is Y, AD is the radius of the circle, is a unit. So we can have the expression given as this, DX of Y equaling to DZ. Now look at the relation between x and y. We can see y is given as the square root 1 minus x squared. 1 is the unit radius of the circle. So apply this relation, we have the expression for the differential dz given as this. We can use Newton's binomial series to expand the binomial function. Here the denominator. So we can have the series for the function as this. We have obtained this before in my talk on Newton's binomial series. So we substitute this into the differentials of dz and dx. So we have the expression as this. And now we can apply the Newton's quadrature rule to obtain the length of the arc, which is calculated as the integral at this and this. So based on the Newton's quadrature rules, we can separate this integral into different terms given as this. All these terms would be the integral for the simple function. Thus, we can obtain the expression for the length of arc zx given as the series as this. So this should be the Newton's initial objective to get the expression for the length of the arc zx. But Newton went further from here to see what he can get. Here, if we use the trigonometry definition x equaling to sine z, then we have z equaling to arc sine x given by this infinite series. Now, Newton performed some magic to complete the series for sine function. That is, use his inverting algorithm to get the relation x as a function of z. In the step 1, we can rewrite the relation of the equation as this. We take this as equation 1. Newton take a first approximation simply by dropping all higher order terms of x. So we have the expression as this. In the step 2, Newton used the expression x equaling to z plus p. This should be a better result for x. And from here, we need to find out what is p. So substitute this relation into the equation 1 here. We have the expression as this. And by ordering the equation using the powers of p, we have the expression as this. The terms in the first bracket are the zero powers of p, and the terms in the second bracket here have order of p, and the terms in the third bracket have the order of p squared, and so on. In Newton's inverting algorithm, we can drop the higher order terms for p squared and higher. So we can solve p from this approximation given as this. Then Newton make another approximation for p by keeping the first terms in the numerator and denominator. P is approximated by this and this. So we have a better expression for x given as z minus 1 over 6 z cubic. In the step 3, we need to seek a better solution for p, which is given as this expression. And now we need to get the expression for q. So the similar procedure by ordering the equation use q and the dropping the high order terms for q, we can solve for q as this. Here we omit the complicated equation for q for simplicity. And then an approximation for q is given as this by keeping the only first terms in the numerator and the denominator. So we have q is approximated as this. So we have a better approximation for x as this. If we continue the inverting procedure, as we can see, Newton obtained the relation given as this, x as the infinite series of z given in this expression. And if we write this into the modern factorial form, so we have the series as this. Here is the summary for how we can finally obtain the infinite series for sine function. From the inverting calculation, we have obtained the relation between x and z, which is actually the inverse relation of z equaling to arc sine x. This means sine z equaling to x. So put this together, we find sine z can be expressed as the infinite series given as this. This is the infinite series Newton derived for sine function. We can see Newton derived this expression only based on his binomial function, quadrature rules, and the inverting algorithm. Such an advancement actually pushes the application of calculus for practical problems, as well as for providing the idea for Taylor to develop his series, the Taylor series. And this could be a good example for validating the Taylor series. See the next slide. In the last slide in this talk, for a comparison, here the infinite series for sine function based on Taylor series is given. Suppose we have a function fx equaling 2 sine x. Then based on the Taylor series, this function fx can be expanded around x equaling to 0, given as this form. Here we can see Taylor series use all different orders of derivatives. The first term on the right hand side is f0 with the 0 derivative, and the second term is the first order derivative term corresponding to the terms of x, and the third term is the second derivative corresponding to the terms of x squared, and the third derivative term for x cubic. And from here we can see the higher order derivatives are expressed as the superscript of the brackets with the number indicating the order of derivatives. So this f bracket 4 is the fourth order of derivative, and so on. Now we have a look at the values of the derivatives at x equaling to 0. Obviously, f0 would be 0, and the first f prime 0 is given as this, so it is 1. And the f double prime, the second order derivative, is 0, and so on. Here we can see all the even order of the derivatives would be 0. See the net expressions. And the odd orders of the derivative would be either 1 or minus 1 alternatively. 1, minus 1, 1, minus 1, 1. So if we put all this into the Taylor series, we can obtain the expression for sine function given as this. This is exactly the same as that Newton derived for sine function. Obviously, if we use Taylor series, the derivation of the infinite series for sine function is much easier. But this is only possible when the calculus and the Taylor series were invented.